Hello visual effects people, I'm AK and this is Fluid Ninja Live 1.8. Before start, I would like to recommend the learning resources, namely the project homepage, the manual, and not only content, but step-by-step guides and links to the tutorial videos, and the new tutorial video, an all-in-one introduction to Ninja Live. Returning to this new release 1.8, we have three features to introduce: rivers, landscape components, and underwater. A very simple blueprint has been added to generate spline meshes for your rivers. All the world space materials have been prepared for these rivers, and there is a new demo level demonstrating how these spline meshes and materials and the simulation containers could be used together. On this level, the river beds are already made with landscape components, and there is a separated level which is demonstrating like a hilly landscape for the same reason. And underwater is featuring caustics now from all point viewpoints. So let us move on to this new level, which is called Use Case 17. Here we go. And first, let me quickly do a run through the level. This is a large river, and we could get underwater. And we have like a huge area. Let me just zoom out. It's like 100 meters wide and kilometers in length with a bridge. Again, zooming in, following this guy here. Where are you? So that's the large river scene, and I'm moving on to this medium-sized river where we also have particle mesh setups with these floaties on top of the water. And we have small-scale rivers in all kind of variations. This one is demonstrating how inverse density could be used with a brush erasing the simulation data to create a somewhat realistic water with ripples. We have two other stages, pretty similar to each other. The point is that we are using an empty simulation area, and things interacting with the simulation area are generating density, so it's the inverse of the previous one. And we have also added some particles. And finally, we have a stage where we are using pre-calculated or baked data for the riverbed stones. So in this case, Ninja is not doing a real-time calculation for all these stones, but we are using like a texture to mask collision, and the water is trying to avoid these rocks by using this collision texture. So these are the stages, and if I zoom out pretty much, we could see how the whole level looks like. So we have a tutorial part which we are going to visit very soon: the large river, the medium size, and the small ones. So, let us start on the tutorial stage, which is stage 0. And it is divided into sub-stages. But the point is that we have a very simple spline generator built in. And of course you could make your own version or use your own custom meshes. This spline generator is really serving the single purpose, enabling us to demonstrate how rivers could be delivered. And the way how Ninja is mapping this spline generator is pretty much the same as it does with all static meshes. I'm returning to these educational materials in the manual. we have a description of it. Chapter 29, per 1, directly driving other systems. So it is described how Ninja could access static meshes and these spline meshes as well. And in the all-in-one tutorial video, we have a dedicated chapter for it, which is chapter 10, directly driving external systems. So I advise you to have a look. I'm not going to explain what direct drive is. The point is that we are tagging these objects. I'm going to the details menu and looking for the... Oh, sorry. This is okay. This is not driven by the simulation because it is just a checkerboard texture thing. But let me approach this guy here first. I make sure, yep, it is using simulation. And for this reason, it should be tagged. And there we go. The tag is example river, and if I click Ninja and I go to Ninja Live component, I could find example river as a tag. So this is how these two guys, Ninja and the spline mesh, finding each other using tags, and you could read about this in the direct drive section. Returning to this part, so we have the spline generator, which is fine. It is a blueprint located in this use case 17 directory. You just drag and drop it on the level, and it is described here how to use it. But the point is that you should pick a static mesh component, which Ninja is going to use, going to duplicate all over the spline mesh. And as a starter, we have two control points, and I could start moving these control points. And as I move one control point further away, the spline mesh is extending. I could also alt-drag the control points, and so I could create new ones. So this is how the spline mesh generator works, and it's described here. It's really simple. Next, how do we map the splines that we have generated? Two ways to go. If you have a look at case A, this checkerboard pattern is following the river curvature, following the river bank. This is really good in case we would like to generate patterns which go along with the flow. And the other one is using word space, which is perfect, no distortions, but it has nothing to do with the shape of the river. And so Ninja and this word space material is utilizing both. On substage 3, we see all the components which are using the local UV. These parts are non-interactive, like this is the river surface foam, this is caustics, and this is like, this is like a distorted geometry. It's creating a noise pattern which is going along this UV space following the river curvature, and here are the three things combined. So these are non-interactive patterns. As you could see, we are in the editor, no simulation is running, and still these patterns are here, moving and combined together. And the material which performs this, I'm just selecting, is the generic word space material. I'm just dragging it here. We are using this material for all kind of purposes, to generate sand and lakes and seas and rivers. And the most important message here, let us go through these patterns. So we have like a foam map, a flow detail map. So here we go, we have a flow map option in the word space material, and please notice flow map in word space is false, which means it is going to use local space. And the same is true for the caustics. I'm looking up the relevant part of the material. Just a second. Single layer water options. Here are the options for caustics. And again, caustics in word space is set to false. So in every case, let me pick the third one as well. This is the river example material, and here's the relevant part, tile map. Just a second. Yep, so this part, the tile map part, and again, tiling in word space is set to false. So we have these three components, caustics, tile map, and flow map all set to use the local space and combined together. Now, this part here demonstrates the real-time generated simulation part. In this case, we are visualizing the pressure buffer, which is like a scalar field, a field of float values between negative and positive one. And this is ideal to create create these ripples. So it could be imagined like a ripple solver. And as you could see, we have this composite of the previous non-interactive patterns, and the simulation is added on top. So this is how the water material works in general. As described here, we have a tutorial video dedicated for the output materials. You could look up these URLs and get to know to the details. But so briefly, that is how the river is set up. So we have a spline mesh generator, and we have some non-interactive components and interactive components all combined together. So this is stage one. And let's have a look at the setup, what we have here on stage. First, we have a Ninja Actor, water simulation plus Niagara, which is controlling the simulation itself. And we are directly driving the spline mesh, this thing here, which is the river surface, and a few interactive objects. By the way, underwater is managed by a pass process volume. So the volume is placed just directly under the water. If I go below the water surface, this post-process material is taking control. Let me just quickly show you. Ah, by the way, let me push the tank inside the water and see how the caustics looks like on the tank surface. It's pretty nice. So in 1.7, we did not have caustics under the water, but now we have it. All right, so where is this post-process material located? I'm going to the content browser, and we have this legacy folder, use case 14, improved word space, and here we go, materials, post-process, here's the base material, underwater post-process. We have a plenty of material instances. In the current case, use case 17, materials, post-process, here we go. By the way, what kind of output materials are we using for this river? Again, I'm selecting Ninja Live Actor and the component, going to Live Generic, and in the secondary output materials section, I could see this is the large water wavy setup that we are using currently. Finally, we have this sand simulation going on. I would not call it a simulation, it is using the simple painter mode again, described in the manual and the all-in-one tutorial. But the point is that we have the river bed here, this sandy area. Yeah, let me move the whole thing. Just let me first try find the gizmo, the control gizmo. So here we go. This is the river bed. And this is a standard Unreal landscape component. Now, we have a problem with landscape components. And I'm going to the details panel. We could assign materials to landscape components in advance, so before the game starts, but we cannot change these materials on the run. Now, the problem with Ninja Direct Drive that it is definitely trying to assign materials in the runtime process, so during play. And so there is this new utility. It's very simple. It only has two input fields. And the input field is for two strings, two tags. First, you select the landscape and you tag the landscape. In this case, it is tagged like Ninja Target Landscape. And you select the actor, which is providing the output. In this case, the footprints for this landscape. And again, it is tagged landscape controller. And so both the landscape and the landscape controller are tagged, and I'm just providing the utility with these tags. In case you open up the utility in Blueprint Editor, you have a very detailed instruction or step-by-step guide how to use it, so we make no mistakes. But it's really simple, just two input fields. And so this way, we have this sandy landscape, which is forming the coastline and the riverbed. And we have the river surface and the underwater. So basically, this stage is demonstrating all the new features that we have. I'm just playing a little bit with the lightning. Why not? So this is how it looks like. Right on. Let me move on to the next stage, which is stage two, this medium-sized river. It's pretty much the same setup, except the scale is lower. But here, we have these mesh particles on the surface. And so, we have these override parameters. I have been selecting the Niagara actor. And here is the spawn rate. If I set it to 4000, we're gonna have a huge amount of balls on top of the water, which is nice. And since these rocks are set to interact with the simulation, of course they interact with the balls driven by the simulation as well. So we have like a few thousands of these mesh particles swirling around the surface. It's oddly satisfying to watch. And if I reduce the number, I could get rid of these guys. And so this is how the underwater looks like here. We are using a different setup compared to stage one, with similar features, underwater caustics. And so let me quickly demonstrate how we swap materials. I just select the simulation actor, going to Ninja Life component, put live generic, and here we go, it's number two, which is the foamy, wavy thing controlling the river. Let me select the crystal clear version. How does it look like? Well, it's pretty clear. No foam, and the dynamics is a bit different. And we have this ending for the river. I've left it like this on purpose, so you could examine how a typical river setup is built. So we have this riverbed, which is a landscape, the sandy surface. And we have the riverbed and the river, which are both spline meshes. So this is the riverbed and the river surface, and it is the same spline mesh, except the river surface is a bit higher positioned, like offsetted. And one is textured with rock, and the other one is with the water. And Ninja is set to control this with the simulation. So much about stage two. Let us move on to stage three. So what do we mean by inverse density? Because that is the point of this stage. Well, if I switch on the simulation itself in its pure raw form, output materials, trace mesh invisible, I switch this off. So probably I will see this huge trace mesh popping into the screen. And as you could see, we have this simulation area filled with noise, and the noise is under the control of the fluid simulation. And as you could see, the things that interact with the simulation are actually erasing the density data, be it a pawn or an object or whatever. So this is what I call the inverse setup. I switch off the trace mesh because it is slightly annoying, and get back and start the simulation. So while watching this, try to imagine that we have this inverted simulation density, and it is really good to generate ripples, and we have nice details, and the whole thing behaves nicely compared to positive density setups, which are a bit more rough in my opinion. I would like to mention a minor feature added. First, I pick the material running this show, selecting component, and here we go, it is the inverse density And so I'm starting it again. And please have a look at these the ripples around the rock. I close all the parameters except the normal map section. And here's this new key feature called Apply Sine Waves to Normal. I'm not going to explain what it is, but if I switch it off, we suddenly lose details. Again, I switch it on, just try to focus on the rock and the amount of details. And there we go. It's like twice or three times as much ripples and more details. I advise you to play with the parameters of this and you will figure out how it works. But the point is that we could enhance the whole simulation with zero effort. So no extra capacity is needed. We are just tricking a little bit and creating a nice detail-rich result. So this is how it looks like. Let's move on to the next stage. And what's the difference between these two guys here? Well, they are almost similar, except we have this green rectangle here, which is visualizing where are the boundaries for the particle simulation. Do you see this Niagara system here? So if I go in, this is the area where particles are generated. So it's like the particle emitter is like a fixed location. If I go outside of that area, you could still see these green posts. There are no particles generated. And I could go underwater. And again, a post-process volume is managing these details. And so let me visit the other stage. And the point here is that, just a second. If I select a Ninja Live actor, I could see that the Niagara is added as a component and there are no boundaries, which means wherever I go, the Niagara component is coming with me. So there is no such thing as I'm running out of the simulated area of no particles at some point. But we have particles all around the place wherever I go. This could be an infinite long river and the same thing would apply. And that is the whole point of making the spline generator and this thing. You could make your own infinite rivers. So the simulation is not bound to a specific location. A reminder, in this case we are using positive density, which means things that interact with the simulation generate density, and around the interacting objects we have like black zero density data. So much about these guys. And I'm moving on to the final stage. As I was hinting, so this is Quixel. This is a Quixel texture. And let me visit the content folder for this Quixel map. We have this texture material called Bedrock Local Space. And if I look up the materials it is using, and I go there with the content browser, it is inside use case 17, it is called the textures. And so we have these regular things like color texture, and we already had this thing called Bedrock Ambient Occlusion. And it is really good for us because the high points are bright and these occluded areas are black. And so I've been using this to generate this occlusion, collision map. So simply applying contrast filters, we have been generating a map where black areas mean no interaction, the fluid cannot go there. And so, since I've been generating the collision map using the original textures, it is in perfect sync spatially. And if I combine these together, I get a water material where my collision mask is falling to the same place where the rocks are. And it's very important to notice that in this case the water simulation actor is not attached to the pawn. So it's like an in a fixed location, and this yellow frame is representing the simulation area, and the simulation is repeated outside this area. So it's a completely different setup compared to the previous stages. But the point is that it's using a local simulation, like in the old times. So we have been doing this technique for ages before word space came along, and we can do that again in order to use this collision map. Again, there are a few things here which we are hinting. What if I switch on a few background elements? I'm going here to the word outliner, and we have the whole level grouped to stages, and this is stage 5, and we have this background plane. I switch on the visibility, and here we go, and I switch on I switch the material to crystal clear. Let's see how it looks like. Foamy crystal clear. Here we go, a nice river creek. And so this background plate is here to test environmental reflections and lighting and stuff. And finally, let me check another material, which is like a very foamy. Probably this one. And hide the background plates again. Here we go. Yep, another one. I wanted to pick another one. Number 3. And I'm just zooming in a little bit. So this is how this guy is looking like in the close-up. We have a lot of details. And the simulation is running in 2K. So this is how it looks like. Okay, time to leave this level. We have been going through these 7 stages, starting with the tutorial and ending up at stage 5. And the next destination is this experimental level, use case 15D, displaying this snow-covered landscape. Yeah, we have a few snow particles, gonna explain this a little bit later. And in live version 1.7, we already had this hill. And as you could see, it is a static mesh. So a regular object. But this one here is a landscape. Now what's the difference? Like, everybody heard about landscapes, but if I summon up this landscape editing tool, I could easily demonstrate how these landscapes. Yeah, let me use a flattened brush, so it's very easy to paint things using this. And once it's done, Ninja is still capable of handling the results. So it's like in editor painted landscape component. And so again, recapping, how does Ninja utilizes these landscape components? I'm going back to the start location. You see this yellow guy here, the landscape utility, with 2 tags, snow source and snow target. And I'm briefly recapping what has been said previously. So here is this guy. Oh, just a second. It is a Ninja switched to simple painter mode. And I've been tagging the Ninja actor as snow source. So it's using the actor tag. And I've been tagging the landscape component as snow target. And so I provided both tags to the landscape utility. And again, by opening the blueprint, you could have a proper read through and a step-by-step guide of how it works. But it's really simple. It's just connecting Ninja to a landscape. And we have another simulation actor here, which is generating a real fluid simulation, so it's not simple painter, and the simulation is used to generate velocity field for the particles in case you would like to have some snow. Ah, yes, let us play again with the lights a little bit. So this is how it works. And so we have been checking the underwater already, so it's really not much to talk about again. Let me quickly revisit that level just to pick up an underwater material. So we are in editor, and as you could see, these post-process materials work fine without the simulation running. And so, if I go to the word outliner and pick stage 1, here I spot the post-process actor, and on the actor details panel I could actually pick the material which is used to map this underwater space. I go there, I open up this material instance, and as you could see, we have a separate group for caustics. So this is where you control the density and brightness and offsetting of the caustics. This is the new feature in the underwater post-process material. So shortly that's it. I'm returning to this introductory level and recapping. We have been talking about the spline-based rivers, geometry, materials, and the example level, the landscapes, and briefly the caustics. By the way, we have a separate tutorial video on the caustics. I might give you a notice that at my YouTube channel you could find all these thematic playlists, and there is this one called Life 1.7. I'm going to rename it to 1.7 and 1.8, and there you will find the all-in-one tutorial, the caustics, new features, so all thematic videos. I advise you to have a look at these. So shortly that's it about Fluid Ninja Live 1.8 and the new features. Thank you for your patience, and see you next time.